So my name's Fionn Ferreira. I'm 23 years old, and I like to think of myself, I think I am an inventor and also a scientist. I really enjoy inventing and playing with scientific ideas, hopefully also making a positive impact on the environment and the planet by doing so. When I hear the word microplastic, the most important thing is to have an image on your mind of something that you cannot see. Because microplastics are almost invisible. They're a pollution form that we can barely see. They're sometimes in a nanoscale compared to some larger pieces of plastic that we see. And that means that they are literally invisible. They're sometimes 10 times smaller in size than the width of a human hair, which means that they are really, really harmful to our bodies because they can be absorbed into our bodies and can bring things like cancer and Alzheimer's around our body and also make these diseases worse. But I'm actually quite worried about the pollution that they're causing, and I literally see them everywhere. Microplastic particles are incredibly tiny plastic particles. So if you think about a pen or a piece of plastic that's larger, that's a macroplastic, something that's big. But when this crushes up against rocks, for instance, when it's in the sea, or when it, for instance, is exposed to light, UV light, which breaks it down, or even if it was made as a microplastic particle, it basically means that it gets smaller and smaller into smaller pieces. And when these plastic pieces are less than 5 millimeters in size, they're considered what is known as a microplastic. So a small piece of plastic. They can go all the way down to the nano or even pico scale, where you have super tiny plastic particles. I grew up in literally, maybe not the middle of nowhere, but definitely somewhere very remote in West Cork, in Ireland. So Ireland is a beautiful island, but it is on the coast to the Atlantic. And that meant that on the beautiful days there on the seashore, my favorite hobbies are kayaking, sailing, exploring the wilderness, I saw a lot of plastic washing up on the coastline around where I lived, and I wanted to try and measure how much there was and see where it came from. So I started categorizing the big plastic particles I saw on the beach and realized they were coming from all over the world. But more scarily, a lot of them were brittle and were falling into smaller and smaller pieces, eventually becoming these invisible microplastics. So I decided that, well, the threat to our beaches was not the big plastic that we can see, but actually the way more dangerous, the invisible plastic particles that almost all the fish and all the plants are consuming and taking in, causing detrimental harm and ultimately even end up in our water. After learning about the problem of the microplastic pollution and really seeing how much there was, I decided, well, need to find a way that I can at least clean the water that I drink from day to day from plastic. So that's what sparked my initiative to try and remove plastics from water. And I wasn't getting very far. I looked into filters and there wasn't really anything on the market until I was walking along the beach and I saw some oil spill residues. This is some oil that probably left the boat. It sticks together into these sticky lumps on the beach. But to it, I just saw tons and tons of plastic stuff. And I thought, well, why is this happening? Turns out plastic and oil are both the same kind of polarity. They're both hydrophobic, meaning that they're repelled by water. That means that they actually stick together when in the presence of water. So that's what kind of made me realize that, well, if one could use an oil to pick up plastic, maybe that could be used as a way to pick up microplastics too. That's when the idea of magnetizing the oil came to be, when I add magnetic particles to the oil. So I essentially used this oily mixture with some magnetic particles inside to pick up microplastics from water, just using magnets. During building my device, I found it actually really, really, quite difficult because I, didn't have a very strong scientific background or support system in terms of scientists who were mentoring me. Instead, I had, my incredible parents who could help me build basically whatever device I wanted, or people in my surroundings who knew a lot about plastic. But I was really on my own in terms of the science. So, well, I started out by just trying this out. I already had this device that I had to measure the amount of plastics in water, but actually developing a good, rigorous testing methodology that I know how much plastic I'm removing with this method, that was quite a challenge. And I found it was 87% effective, but this took a lot of work in perfecting a method to do this. Quite a few projects and experiments didn't work out very well. I think it was particularly in the early stages when I was trying to make these devices to actually test the microplastics in water. It was just crazy. I mean, I would build something and then it wouldn't work. and then it would build something else, and then it would catch fire, or there was an electrical fault, or then the software didn't work. It felt like actually getting a measurement that meant something and that was a good measurement was so few and far between. I'm not sure if I was always wearing protective gear. I was always pretty lucky, but I think there were a lot of things that went wrong. You know, I may have caused a power outage for my local village a couple of times by short-circuiting things, but nobody ever heard about it, so it's fine. I think one of the most surprising things for me was actually at the beginning when I did this testing to see how much plastic there is everywhere. I thought microplastics were a pollution form that we are exposed to, but I didn't realize that basically every glass of water, every piece of seafood, every single piece of food essentially contains a lot of plastic. A lot of it is fluorinated too. When we take in microplastic, it's not just the microplastic itself that we need to be afraid of. We need to be afraid of so much more. For instance, the toxic compounds that stick to the plastic when they're in the oceans. So for me, learning that we consume over 5 grams of plastic every week, that's a credit card's worth, was super shocking and scary, but also very motivating. And that's what's kind of pushed me to continue doing this. And with that, we can basically work with companies who want to extract microplastics from water. For instance, existing water treatment companies can collaborate with us and use our technology or our formula in their own devices. We're looking at scaling this into larger scale devices that could be used in a whole river or a wastewater treatment plant for larger scale microplastic removal on a worldwide scale. For anybody who wants to make a difference in environmental science or different things like this, the most important thing of all is to go outside. You can only do things that are good for the environment and good for the planet if you actually care about the planet. So the most important thing is to fall in love with your planet, where you live, and therefore I would say go outside, experience it, do what you love doing. For me, that's kayaking, hiking, sailing, that kind of thing. Do that. Then once you see problems that are affecting the planet, learn more about them. Understand the causes and maybe understand some of the other efforts that are done to try and mitigate. See if you can apply them yourself. I think applying a solution is just as important, if not more important, than actually coming up with a solution. But if there's no solution out there, well then, what are you waiting for? Come up with the solution. No idea is too weak or too small that it can't make a difference. So let every idea have the power to change the way you think, and let every idea shape you into a scientist. If you want to reduce microplastic pollution in your daily life, the most important thing is to look at the labels of your clothing. Plastic clothes, so clothes that contain nylon, polyester, elastane, whenever you wash them, shed tens of thousands, if not millions, of plastic particles, and these are just going into the water. There are certain filters for washing machines, but most of these don't have full effectiveness, so instead, the best thing you can do is try and find clothes that use natural fibers instead. So think cotton, wool, that kind of thing. Silk, maybe. These are all fibers that don't shed as much plastic. Try and tell other people about what you're doing and try and just leave plastic items out of your life. I think the issue of microplastic pollution is actually an issue that is not just related to microplastics, but plastics as a whole. When we create plastic products, we should try and redesign when we use plastic, because plastic is a really precious material. It's a material that might maybe like last a really long time, could last our entire lifetime. And that means that plastic also, we need to be careful on how we use this very, very, I guess, scarce resource. It's something we should treat like wood or metal, something for things that stick around, and not something that we just throw away after 10 minutes. Because only like that will we really reduce plastic pollution that we're causing. Because at the moment, most plastic pollution is packaging, where I think other things need to be found. So treating plastic as a long-term resource and material instead of a short-term one, that is the key change we need to see.